Okay, guys, so before the break, last we looked, we were talking about sex-linked traits and more specifically how dominant and recessive traits are passed from parent to child and the traits that are found on your X and your Y chromosomes, which are your sex chromosomes. All right, so what we're going to do today is we're going to start talking specifically about how we can illustrate the traits that are passed from generation to generation. And we do this with tools called pedigrees. Now, just for quick review, we have a total of 23 pairs of homologous chromosomes. So this means that we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. Whenever it says homologous, it means that they're the same size. Okay, so we have a total of 23 pairs of chromosomes that are the same size and that pair together. All right, next, 22 of these pairs are autosomes. So these are found in body cells. All right, so these are not our sex cells, these are body cells. It's not what makes us a girl or a boy, these are just body cells. So like your skin cells, your brain cells, your heart cells. All right, so 22 of these pairs are autosomes. And finally, one of these pairs are sex chromosomes. So these are found in the egg or the sperm. And you guys know from review and from last we talked before break that if you are a woman, you have two X chromosomes, and if you are a man, you have an X and a Y. All right, so that goes with what we just talked about right here. So the female has an XX and the male has an XY. All right, and just to illustrate this down here, okay, so numbers 1 all the way through 22, do you see how they're kind of like the same size? Okay, that is your homologous pairs of chromosomes. Those are your autosomes. Numbers 1 through 22 are your autosomes, and then right down here are going to be your X's and your Y's. Okay? All right, so if the trait that we're talking about is autosomal, that means that it's on numbers 1 through 22 and it's not on your sex chromosomes. If the trait we're talking about is sex-linked or X-linked, then it means that we're going to find it on our sex chromosomes, so the X or the Y. Now remember, do we rarely find X-linked traits or sex-linked traits on the Y chromosome. That's most of the time why they're called X-linked traits, because it's very rare to find them on the Y chromosome. All right, remember, that's why men have a higher percentage or a higher rate of getting certain disorders that are sex-linked, is because they don't have that extra layer of protection that women have. All right, now, moving into what we're going to talk about pedigrees. All right, I gave you a note sheet. You should have cut that out and put it in your notebook already. So now we're going to go ahead and start filling that in. If you look towards the bottom, you'll see questions that ask you why we use pedigrees and what we can use pedigrees for. Okay, so a pedigree is kind of like a family record. It's kind of like your family tree. And it instead of showing, though, who married who and what children they had, yes, it shows that, but it also shows how a trait is inherited or passed along. Okay, so we use pedigrees to determine how certain disorders or traits are passed within a family. All right, and this is very useful most of the time for men and women who are getting married and want to have children, and they want to see what type of traits they're going to pass on to their children. It's very important for that use. But people and families aren't the only reason we create and use pedigrees. We also create them for dogs, horses, to demonstrate breeding standards. So if you've ever owned like a pit bull or a Boston Terrier or a Yorkie, okay, you want to own a purebred, right? And a pedigree is one of the ways that we illustrate whether that dog is purebred or not. We would use a pedigree to figure out whether the dog is 100% pit bull or 100% Yorkie or 100% Boston. Okay, that's how we demonstrate it, is by using pedigrees. All right, so that really just goes into what it is and what we use it for. So that's the answer to those two questions down at the bottom. All right, now we're going to go into what the symbols mean. All right, so if we look at pedigree, so off to the side, right here where my cursor is, we're going to go into looking at it and learning about what the symbols are. All right, so on Pedigrees, you're going to see two different shapes. You're going to see circles and you're going to see squares. Circles always represent females. Squares always represent males. Now, you're also going to see three different things. You're going to see some that are just regular non-shaded in, like this square, this circle. You're going to see some that are completely shaded in, like this circle right here. And you're going to see some that are only half shaded, like this square right here. Now, if you see a circle that is not shaded, it means that this female, okay, because circles represent females, it means that this female is normal. They do not have that trait or disorder that we're trying to illustrate with this pedigree. All right? If you see a square that is not filled in, okay, it's not shaded, okay, this means that this male is normal. It does not have that trait or disorder that we're illustrating with this pedigree. However, if you look at a darkened shape, okay, one that is completely filled in, like this circle or this square, that is representative of a female or a male with that trait or disorder. So if you see a circle that is completely filled in, that is a female with the trait or with the disorder. They are affected by that trait or by that disorder. If you see a square, okay, that is completely filled in, that is a male with that trait or with that disorder. All right? Now, shapes that are half shaded, all right, these represent carriers. All right, carriers. Now, there are two different types of carriers. There's a male and there's a female. If you remember from us talking about yesterday, remember that the only way you can have a carrier male is if the trait or disorder that you are talking about is not sex-linked, right? Because we cannot have male carriers if the trait is sex-linked. You can't, right? Why? Because sex-linked traits are only carried on the X chromosome, and males do not have two X's. And in order for somebody to be a carrier, you have to have two of the same allele, or two of that allele. You have to have a dominant and a recessive. And males don't have two X's, so they can't have two of those alleles. They can only have one. Okay, so the only time you can have a carrier male is only possible with traits that are not sex-linked. All right, carrier females, they don't have the trait, but it's like they're carrying it along with them. Okay, so it's like boys and girls, like if you carry your money around in your wallet. I can't see your money, but that doesn't mean you're not carrying it around. It's just like with this right here, with a carrier female. They don't have the trait, they don't exhibit the symptoms of the trait, but that doesn't mean that they don't have it in their allele stash. That doesn't mean that they don't exhibit it, okay? Got it? Alrighty. So those are the signs, and those are the signs that you're going to see when you look at a pedigree. Alright, those are the symbols. Alright, now also another good thing to pay attention to is parents or people that are married. Okay, marriage, parents are represented with a male and a female symbol connected by a horizontal line. So the reason this box is highlighted is to show you this right here. So if you look, this square and this circle, they're connected by that horizontal line. Okay, they're connected to one another, which means they are parents or they are married. They're connected with a horizontal line in the middle. All right, now offspring in pedigrees are represented by symbols that are connected by a vertical line to a horizontal line that's above. Okay, so you see you've got this horizontal line that's above it. Your parents are being connected to the children. Okay, so here is how you represent children. You've got a vertical line that's connected to that horizontal line above it. And then off of it, you draw this horizontal line and then draw your children coming down from it. So as you can see, these two people were married. This man and this affected woman were married. All right, and they had four children. All right, so circled in the figure are the four children. So these four children, you've got a son and a daughter, a son and a daughter. All right, so that's how you tell that these people had four children. All right, All right, so now just for example, all right, if you were to look at this pedigree and I were to ask you how many generations it had, okay, you use to determine the amount of generations, you always look at the Roman numerals off to the side. Okay, so this is showing you 1, 2, 3 generations. All right, so you've got a grandparent generation, a parent generation, and then children. So grandparents, parents, children. So that's what you're looking at right here. You've got 3 generations represented by the 3 Roman numerals. So this right here is 1 generation. This right here is 2. And then this right here is 3. All right. Now, remember, if this trait is X-linked, then you have to carefully consider the shapes. Remember, males and females. So if this trait is X-linked and I have a male carrier, then you know you've messed up because you can't have male carriers if the trait is sex-linked. You can't have that. That's not an option. All right, so you know that if you have a male carrier in somewhere in a pedigree, that it's not a sex-linked trait. All right, because you can't have that. Males cannot be carriers. So you always have to carefully consider the shapes of the males and the females. Okay? And if I am not mistaken, that is all for today. So that is the introduction to pedigrees that we were going to go over. I have 2 sheets for you. On the back of your note sheet, all right, is a lovely just little walkthrough of pedigrees and what they are. And then you also have a homework assignment that you have to do as well. All right, so you need to glue those notes into your notebook. Make sure you have those notes in there. And then you have a follow-up activity that you also have to paste into your notebook, as well as a homework assignment that you do not have to paste into your notebook, but that you are going to do for homework. All right, so make sure you get both of those things done. I will be checking those tomorrow. Enjoy the video and let me know if you have any questions. All righty.